Same-sex love and gender diversity have long been a part of English history, but these stories, these voices, haven't always been a part of the official record, and at museums and heritage sites, they've often been hidden. In my historical novels, I've tried to engage imaginatively with the past as a way of thinking about how people in the past who perhaps didn't fit into gender and sexual norms might have lived their lives, might have experienced their desires, might have made friends, found partners, been politically active. Getting a sense of the gay past, mapping out the places in which people with same-sex desires might have lived, is a fascinating thing to do. It's a kind of detective work. You know, these are lives that are often secret, hidden, lives that were made furtive. It's also, I think, a really important thing to do, because if we leave out the LGBTQ presence from our accounts of history, we're not telling the whole story. Queer historic places include stately homes and country houses with a history of same-sex love, places like this, Shibden Hall in Yorkshire, home to 19th century lesbian Anne Lister. But ordinary people's LGBT experiences are just as important, the streets, homes and workplaces of everyday life. The meeting places of 1980s activists, the corner pubs frequented by Victorian cross-dressers, these are all part of our historic environment. Everywhere, every place has a queer history. These are places that were sometimes hidden, sometimes criminalised, but they're all now claimed with pride. They remind us of iconic figures from the past, figures like Oscar Wilde, prosecuted in 1895 for gross indecency and sentenced to a prison term in Reading Jail. These are places that memorialise injustice and persecution. More positively, other places testify to long-lasting love between women or between men. It's also important to identify and celebrate places of pleasure and fun. The public baths that were sites of same-sex opportunity, the homes where queer couples spent their lives together, the music halls and theatres where male and female impersonators entertained women and men in the audience, straight and queer, and suggested erotic possibilities beyond those of conventional marriage. Some places encompass both illicit and respectable queer heritage. Churchyards might be cruising grounds, as St Paul's Churchyard, Covent Garden was in the 18th century, for example. But churches are also places where queer couples unofficially solemnised their unions, or where we sometimes find memorials to long-lasting passionate same-sex partnerships. Romantic friendships between women were commonplace in the 19th century. It was routine for women to express their affections for each other in intense and passionate ways. Historians have usually assumed that these relationships, though, were decidedly chaste. But of course, Anne Lister's diaries make us think again about that. You know, there she was, writing explicitly about the sexual encounters she was having with other women. One of the things I love about the diaries is the fact that when she makes a move on a woman, the other woman never seems terribly surprised. They seem to take it in their stride. She found no difficulty in finding women to be her lovers. So I think what's crucial about the diaries is that they make us rethink the landscape of women's domestic life in the early 19th century. They make us understand that the way women used space in their homes, it wasn't just in the decorous Jane Austen way we're used to thinking about, but they were using it for their own purposes, for their own pleasures. One of the interesting issues we face when we talk about sex and sexuality in the past is what words to use. The terms we're in the habit of using, words like gay, bi, trans, they're very modern words. Even the words homosexual and heterosexual were coined only in the second half of the 19th century. They were coined at exactly the time when people were beginning to talk about sexuality in a new way, in a modern way, the way that we've inherited. But if we want to talk about same-sex desires in earlier periods, we have to be a bit more flexible. Queer is a word I've always felt very at home with. I've used it a lot in my writing, usually in its very old-fashioned sense of meaning something odd or peculiar, something outside the mainstream, perhaps troubling or challenging to the mainstream. I think that's rather a good place to be, actually. It's a word that hasn't been always easy for LGBT people to hear because it's often been levelled against us as an insult. But from the early 1990s, it's been kind of reclaimed as a very powerful word of self-definition. it's, as a word, it can't possibly describe all the varieties of individual ways in which people in different places and different eras have challenged sex and gender norms, but it can embrace all those different ways, and it can gesture to the connections between them. Pride of place uses queer as an inclusive term to welcome in all the various diverse communities of LGBTQ life.